Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 90 and 91, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And of course, you could get us on your app, on your smartphone. You could see us everywhere. Also, today, I have a very special show after this show. We're doing Table Talk, but it's just going to be me and Dr. Rose Moten, and we're going to talk about domestic violence because October is Domestic Violence Month, and we're not only going to take it from the adult perspective, we're going to talk about why the young people need to be schooled in domestic violence. Also, my first show is very exciting. I have someone I wanted to get on this show Kim Trent. I say that because, well, you'll understand why. And then we have David Tarver and Mr. Sean Whitehead, or Attorney Sean Whitehead, I should say. Good morning, Kim.
Good morning, Brenda.
You know why I was saying that.
It's a pleasure to be here with you.
You too. I was saying that because I said, this is Ken Coleman's wife.
That's right.
And I was saying Mrs., but it's, you know.
That's I'm one of those women who kept my maiden name, but no disrespect to my husband.
I know.
But it's funny because that is confusing for people because they want to say Mrs. Trent, but then I'm not actually Mrs. Trent, I'm Miss.
Right. Well, let's get right into it. Kim, I'm so impressed with you, the work you're doing on behalf of Enough Said, and then you have the other foundation you work for?
Well, I work for a think tank called Michigan Future.
Okay, we'll talk about that in a moment, but I want to give the audience a little bit of your background. Mm-hmm. Now, you grew up here in Highland Park.
I grew up in Highland Park. I sure did, on Louise Street.
Wow, yeah, right across the
went
street.
Went to Old St. Benedict.
Oh, you went to...
I did.
You're a Catholic school girl,
I'm
too.
I'm a Catholic school
Me
girl,
too.
Yes.
I went to St. Teresa's.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my mother did, too.
I graduated. She did?
Oh, yeah.
What's her name?
Well, it was Deborah Walton back then, and... Yeah.
No, we won't say years. We'll talk about that
off air, right?
Then where'd you go?
Then I went to Cass Tech.
Of course.
And then I went to Wayne State. I was in one of the first classes of a program called the Journalism Institute for Minorities.
Okay.
Which is an honors program at Wayne State to try to get, that was designed to get more students of color in our nation's newsrooms, which is still a huge problem. Actually, it's much worse than it was when I was a journalist. I started my career as a journalist covering City Hall during the last 2 years of Mayor Young's administration.
Wow.
So I'm dating myself. But
No.
Yeah, but
I mean, you're just 23.
Of course. Yeah, I did that when I was in junior high.
Right? I know. You were that advanced.
Right.
And then what did you do?
So I worked at the Detroit News for actually a total of 8 years. And then I left. We had the strike in 1995 that a lot of people remember. I moved to Africa for a year, actually, and lived in Cape Town, South Africa.
Did you?
I did. I love that.
That was exciting.
It was incredible. And I was there, you know, really kind of in the midst
still
of
apartheid
the
apartheid.
It had just kind of made the transition, but it was very much still a very divided country.
Yeah.
I was there when they adopted their new constitution.
Wow.
I was in the room the day the F.W. de Klerk apologized for apartheid.
Oh.
I mean, I was there when had the first African-American or African president of a major university Mampela Rampele, who went on to run the World Bank, who was Steve Biko's lover. I mean, just really fascinating time to be in South Africa.
It was very exciting.
So I'm very grateful that I had that opportunity.
That's a great opportunity.
It was. Then I moved back here and moved to Washington, worked on Capitol Hill for a while with Congresswoman Carolyn Kilpatrick.
Oh, well, wonderful.
And then Senator Debbie Stabenow and Governor Granholm. So that's all my went from covering politicians to working for them.
Wow, that was a stretch.
It was different. It was definitely a different skill set.
Yeah, you had to put on certain things you don't have blinders on for, and then politics, you have to sometimes put some blinders
on.
I
always tell people, I think a career as a journalist is the perfect training ground for almost anything you want to do in life, because it teaches you how to be resourceful, how to obviously communicate, which is a skill that you can use in any career, how to network. I mean, it's a really, I'm so grateful because like most high school seniors, I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life. So I will always be grateful to Luther Keith, who chose me for the Journalism Institute for Minorities.
Luther, that's everybody's guy.
Right, he's a great human being.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And you're working on Enough Said.
I am.
Why don't you tell the audience about this? Mm-hmm. This is so important. We've heard a lot about it, but a lot of people don't know the name of it.
Yes. So Enough Said is an acronym for Enough Sexual Assault in Detroit, and it was launched in January 2015 by Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy, the Detroit Crime Commission, and the Michigan Women's Foundation. And the idea was, when I worked for Governor Granholm, we discovered in 2009, the prosecutor's office discovered 11,341 rape kits in an abandoned room, a room that just, a storage room that people just were throwing the rape kits in there and nothing was happening with them. Some of these kits date back as far as 35 years. So they just sat in a room. So a lot of these survivors never got justice.
Never
got their day in court. And beyond that, it's a safety issue because they have identified through these kits 700 serial rapists and 50 men who rape between 10 and 15 women. So these are very dangerous people who are going to continue to.
So they got them off the street?
Well, so what we're doing now, we're in the process. They've already processed 10,000 of the 11,341 kids. I and other black
10,000, that's
10,000. No, they've done a great job. No, Prosecutor Worthy and her team have done an excellent job of raising money for this cause. Peg Tallett and the team over at the Michigan Women's Foundation have been very innovative in their approach to get this money.
Well there Carolyn was still 1,300. Kaysen and
Karen
I, we sang your praises when she was on the show.
How wonderful. Yeah, they're doing really important work. So we realized that 81% of the survivors who didn't get their kids processed are African-American women. So we said black women should play a major role in raising money for this cause.
Absolutely.
So we came together, actually it was a year ago yesterday, we stood on the steps of the Detroit Association of Women's Clubs, and we said, we are going to raise enough money for the remainder, the balance of the kids, which is 1,341 kids. Kim Worthy was able to get the cost of each kit to have it processed down to $490. Because normally it's between $1,200 and $1,500 for one kit. Yeah. So she was able to negotiate a really good price. So at $490 times 1,341, that gets us our number of $657,000.
So once they discovered these people, these perpetrators, what happens?
Well, it depends. So in some cases, and that's the other thing, I think people think of this as a Detroit problem, but it really isn't, because they have identified the people who whose DNA has been identified because of these kits being processed. They live all over the country. They've identified 39 different states where these folks have fanned out to, or where they've raped other women. So this is, don't just think that this is just a problem that's contained in Detroit because it's not as if rapists don't cross boundaries.
Well, this made national news.
Yeah, well, but the thing that people also should recognize, this is not a uniquely Detroit problem.
Right.
There are kits all over the country that haven't been processed. Memphis
had
13,000.
Why do you think that is?
Well, I have my theories. I mean, obviously, we could take a long look at how women's lives are valued in our society. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that that's a part of it. And then also, I had a conversation with one of our former police chiefs who really did make the salient point. If you have to choose between having officers on the street and processing rape kits, the decision over the years, I mean, and it's understandable. I mean, we're a city that people feel like you want to see police officers on the street. You want to feel that there's safety. And so if there's that priority, if you have to prioritize, unfortunately, we ended up on the negative end of things. But I think that it's important for us to recognize the great thing that came out of this is that Kim Worthy was able to get legislation passed by Lansing to ensure that this will never happen again. So that's why it's been.
So what happens now to the person who might have been molested last mm-hmm. week?
So now within 90 days, a kid has to be processed and has to be at least has to be processed. So, you know, there's some things that we have to do to tighten up the legislation. I would like to see more punitive measures for communities that don't do. I mean, now it is a law, but the law doesn't really have enough teeth for my taste. I'd like to see a little bit more. But I think that
are they able to test them at this budget price?
Well, that's a good question. I actually don't know the answer to that question. I mean, I know that Kim Worthy was able to negotiate that price for Wayne County. You know, I don't know about in other jurisdictions whether they were able to do it. But the fact of the matter is Vice President Joe Biden has been very involved in this issue. So there's more federal resources to solve this problem. Because as I said, New York City, Los Angeles, Memphis, Tennessee, all over the country, this is the problem. In fact, USA Today did a story last year where they said that at least 70,000 kids nationwide, at least, and that's a very conservative number, were not processed. So the difference is, you know, Mayor Young used to say, when the rest of the country gets a cold, Detroit gets pneumonia. Yeah. So although a lot of other communities have this problem, they were able to find governmental resources to deal with it. We're the only city where we have to raise private dollars because, you know, as you know what's happened in the city over the last 10 years. We underwent the largest municipal bankruptcy in the history of America. Right. We saw the near collapse of GM and Chrysler. So when you have those kind of problems that are going on, it's difficult to, as horrible as the situation is, it was hard to convince people that $28 million right. for that was right. the best use of our resources.
Right, right, absolutely. So what will happen to these perpetrators?
Well, I mean, ideal. Right now, we're over 50. We have over 50 perpetrators who are in prison today because of these kids. And that might sound like a low number, but you have to remember these are serial rapists. So, they're trying to prioritize by how many victims there are, how dangerous the person are, you know, how deadly his action was.
Whether they just raped him, or raped him and hurt him,
right?
Or
exactly.
Him.
Uh-huh. Some of these folks are already in prison and maybe on the way out, and so you want to prioritize that person, make sure they don't leave. So, you know, they have trying to prioritize who gets out and who gets investigated. So the problem is, so for example, in Cleveland, they had 3,500 kids. Cleveland had 35 investigators. When we first started this process, Detroit had 12, and we have 11,341 kids.
Oh my goodness.
So you can see how far behind we are. So in addition to raising money to process the kids, we also have to get resources to get more investigators and to get more prosecutors to actually prosecute the cases, because it's been a little slow going in getting the cases prosecuted because they just don't have the resources. Luckily, the Wayne County executive did give $1 million to the prosecutor to try to boot and some office space so that she can get more folks in the office for this purpose to clear this backlog. But, you know, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done.
So they prioritize it by the gravity of the...
Well, it depends. There are a lot of different factors that go into which cases get investigated. And, you know, some cases, for example, we had a young woman who sadly was raped on her 21st birthday. And
by a known or unknown?
Well, that's the thing. It was her boyfriend at the time's cousin. So she knew the person, but because her kid hadn't been processed, it just sat on a shelf for 10 years. Well, 12 years, actually. And so her kid was processed in February, and the minute her kid got processed, the person got arrested almost the very next day. So, so in cases like that,
she knew where he was.
You know, so I mean,
isn't that something?
It's horrible. But in a lot of these cases, these are unknown assailants,
right?
But these are people who have attacked more than one person. They might have been arrested and convicted of other crimes. So, they may already be under probation, or they might have some kind of surveillance that's already taking place with them.
Or some might have gone to jail on other.
Exactly. Right. So there are some folks who already were in prison. We had one woman I know who her kid sat for 20 years. And when they finally ran her kid, they discovered that the person who raped her also raped 13 other women. And he was in prison for one of the rapes, for one of the other rapes. But now he's going to be in prison for the rest of his life because of all the other kids that have come, that have been processed because of this.
Imagine. And this has been going on. How far back do the rape
35 kid? Years. Well, the kids, well, I mean, DNA technology obviously isn't 35 years old, but right. some of these kids just kind of have been sitting on a shelf for years and years and years, even when we knew that we had the technology to be able to compare DNA results with other kids that were already in the system.
So if the person knew the perpetrator, I'm not in the law.
Yeah, sure.
If a person knew the perpetrator and they got their rape kit done, then they'd have to wait for this rape kit thing? They couldn't?
In this case, they did. It seems crazy to me, too. But, yeah, in this case, and then obviously sometimes it's trickier when you know the assailant because, you know, people say things about consent. But she went and got a rape kit immediately. So, I mean, there was evidence that she had been assaulted. So, anyway, that one's still being adjudicated, so I don't want to get
deeper
into that particular case.
Right. But, like I said, if it happened day before yesterday. Well, okay, will my rape kit be, do I have to wait in line for something that happened recently?
No, because now we have new legislation that guarantees your kit is going to be processed. So there's the backlog that still has to be handled, but modern day cases, there's a whole different unit that's dealing with that. So no, it's not like you have to stand in line behind people from 20 years ago or 10 years ago. Your kit will order within 90 days. Your kit will be processed now because of the legislation we
have. Let's talk a little about that too, about the fact that sometimes they're known assailants, mm-hmm. and some people never come forth. Mm-hmm. Isn't that true?
It's very true. Well, I am a survivor of a sexual assault, and I knew my assailant. I didn't know him very well. He was someone who actually worked at my place of employment, and I didn't report. Kim Worthy is also was violently raped when she was a law student, and she didn't report. And I think that one of the things that we want to dispel is some of the mythology around what a sexual assault victim looks like, what motivates.
Right.
Because there's some, even a very well-known law enforcement official in Detroit, I was at an event where he said, well, if these women would report, we wouldn't have this many problems. So there's a lot of victim blaming that goes on.
That's what I was getting ready to
exactly.
say. Remember the movie The Accused?
Yes.
And
yes, that happens every day.
And they'll blame a woman for the way she dresses, the way she looks, the way
what did you do? What were you doing there with him?
Right,
and
right.
why were you out? And I mean, there's a lot.
Almost like you don't have the, even if you say no, it doesn't mean anything.
It doesn't. I mean, a lot of times it doesn't. Well, and the good thing about Vice President Biden and a lot of the efforts that have gone on, I'm on the board of Wayne State University, so college campuses all over the country are really grappling with this issue of consent. And I think it's great that you're at least having the conversation so that both parties realize that there is culpability. Because a lot of times, just because of the way our culture looks at women, all the onus is put on women. Why were you in his dorm room? Well, why were you, is it?
Well, I heard that Wayne State just got a grant for something that deals with dating violence or domestic abuse.
Yes. Well, I mean, that's the great thing about it. There's attention now. And even a campus like Wayne State, which is a commuter college for the most part, but we're really boosting our housing population on campus. We're building new housing.
I
we have
that.
Housing that has come online in the last 10 or 20 years, and we're getting a lot more students who want to come to Detroit. They want that urban experience, and because Midtown is, kind of buzzing now. So, a lot of problems that we traditionally haven't had to grapple with as much because we weren't so much a residential college, we're dealing with. And so we're really happy that we're getting out ahead of it so that we're setting a tone on our campus so people understand that there is accountability.
Yes, and college, you hear about it all over the country, mm-hmm. what things that happen mm-hmm. in college, and I know of young women who have been victims.
Oh, sure.
And that victim shaming and blaming, mm-hmm. that's another reason women said they haven't come forth.
Exactly.
And then sometimes it's a family member, sometimes it's the mother's boyfriend.
Yes, a lot of times, sadly.
I taught high school
right.
for, mm-hmm. and I heard so many stories. I had to report. It was my
duty.
Your duty,
of course.
And the mothers, I've had mothers get mad at me. They had just, I mean, these mothers who just were so happy these girls were in my class and this and that. Then all of a sudden when I have to report, because teachers are mandated to report this, they're just shunning me and all that, which I didn't care.
It's tragic. I mean, any mother who would prioritize.
Say if there's someone watching right now who says, who didn't report a rape. It's too late if you haven't gotten a rape kit or what?
Well, I would say call the prosecutor's office. And I mean, you know, it depends on how long ago.
Because what if you can't you launch the charge?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a lawyer, so I'm a little
hesitant. Because I'm wondering, Sean's a lawyer. No, about having, I don't have a rape kit, but I can accuse this person of having done this.
Well, sadly, we do have statutes of limitation for sexual assault, except for in cases of first-degree criminal sexual assault. And to be honest with you, it's a mystery to me because I've heard of cases. One of the victims that we work with was 12 and convinced her mother to allow her to take the bus. She had been begging her mom, because you know when you're 12, especially 20 years ago, you think you're almost grown, right? Yeah. When I was 12, I took the bus by myself all the time.
I had to take the Dexter bus over to, I was at the Detroit Conservatory of Music.
Piano lessons. Oh, yeah, yeah, right.
So I was able to take that bus myself.
Absolutely. And so, I mean, and we, you know, it was very common. But this mother, this was in the 90s, so she was a little bit more reluctant. She said, you know, it's not safe. Mm-hmm. Her daughter finally convinced her to let her take the bus. Mm-hmm. The very first day she took the bus by herself, a man dragged her away from the bus stop, took her to an abandoned home, raped her repeatedly, and then insisted on walking her back to the bus stop because I guess he wanted to make sure she was going to be safe. So as he walked her back, she told him, I'm going to tell the police what you did to me. And he said, ain't nobody looking for me. That was his quote to her. Ain't nobody looking for me. He was right, because her kid sat on the shelf for 20 years. So, I mean, when you hear stories like that, they just chill you to the bone, because you realize these are real human beings whose lives were turned upside down by these kind of things. Now, the good thing about her, and unfortunately in her case, the reason I brought her case up, now, I can't imagine why that wasn't first-degree criminal sexual assault, but for whatever reason, it was considered second degree. And there was a statute of limitations, so her case was not able to go forward. But she was able to testify against this gentleman because he was a serial rapist. And so she was able to tell her story in court, and he did get a tremendous, I think he got 35 years in prison. So he did go to death. She did get some measure of justice, maybe not in her case, but she was able to make sure that this man will never see the light of day again. And unfortunately, that person actually attempted to rape somebody right here in Highland Park, the same assailant, and he raped her over on the east side. So again, this is what I'm saying about boundaries. This is, you know, these are people who will go all over our region and all over the country.
Sick individuals.
They're very sick.
Very, very sick individuals. Well, this, what can, are you still accepting donations?
Absolutely. So we need to raise $657,090. I have it down to the exact dollar amount.
And 15 cents.
Right. We'll take the 15 cents too. We've been very lucky in that we've gotten more than 1,400 individual donations from individuals, from corporations, from groups. We had a sorority challenge back in January. We're going to do it again this year. Last year we did the Wolverines versus the Spartans when the football game was coming up. We raised $30,000 in 1 week with that competition. We had Men's Month. We raised about $30,000 with that. We've tried to, you know, be very creative.
Use innovative ideas.
But we've raised about close to $350,000. We still have to raise another $300,000.
So how could we do that?
So we are continuing our, we're asking folks to do house parties for us. We have some national artists who want to come in and do some events for us. Erykah Badu was kind enough to allow us to collect a $5 upcharge from every ticket she sold at her concert at Shane Park. But beyond that, and this is the other exciting news about it, she also committed to us that for every concert she does from now on, the tickets hadn't already gone on sale, she's going to request that the promoters add that $5 upcharge. For our cause, the African American 490 Challenge. And so she has two concerts coming up in November in Los Angeles and San Diego. And those dollars, we're hoping those dollars are going to, you know, we'll get $5.
Well, she'll sell out. She'll sell out.
She does very well.
This is fabulous. So if we want to give something, what do we do?
Good question. So you can visit our website, which is www.AA490challenge.org. And there's a donate button there. You can, it takes you directly to our page where you can donate.
Now, and AA also, what does that stand for?
AA is African American 490 Challenge, because every kit costs $490 to process.
God, so it seems like it would be a public service, you know, just to do it.
And you know, a lot of times I get asked the question, why should I give my private dollars for this, which is clearly a public commitment? I mean, clearly
we got to do what we got to do.
But, you know, we cannot turn our backs on these survivors who have been waiting for justice. And I want to tell you a story. I was at a restaurant with Kim Worthy. We were having lunch one day, and a woman walked up to us who worked at the restaurant and said, I just want to say thank you that because of you, I was one of the first kids that got processed. Oh, wow. And my assailant, you know, went to prison, and I feel like it gave me my life back. And her coworker came over later and said, thank you for giving me my friend back. She's a different person. Girl. So, I mean, we got chills. So these are real people. And I think when people hear rape kids, it sounds like such a clinical term. Oh, they don't realize that these are real human beings whose lives have been turned upside down.
Turned upside down. Well, I need to have you come back again.
We
come back again and join the table sometime on Table Talk.
Just
let
me know.
I will. You heard it here, ladies and gentlemen. And I think all of us know someone or have been the victim of.
Absolutely. Well, 80% of rape victims don't report. You were asking about that earlier.
I know they don't.
So there are a lot of people out there. So when you do and you go through a horrible process, because collecting evidence for a rape kit is actually very invasive. So you go, and it lasts for hours. So you go through that, and then have your kit sit on a shelf for years. It's so disrespectful. It's such a... you feel as though the people who are there to protect you actually have disrespected you. And so we want to make sure that these women have peace. And not all of them are going to have their assailants convicted,
but
at least they'll know that they were not just ignored, which is what happened here before.
And you think about the fact that mentally and emotionally, how that affects
absolutely
a victim for the rest of their lives.
No doubt about it.
Basically,
right.
You know,
right.
Therapy and all. I mean, sometimes you can't get rid of it.
Sure.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, here she is. And we'll be back in just a moment with David Tarver, who's having a big event in Flint.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
I am on with a very good friend of the show and a good friend, Mr. David Tarver. Hi, David.
Good morning. How you doing, Brenda?
Fine. I forgot your book, like I told you. I have that book out. My son has that book. Great book, Proving Ground.
Thank you.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes. And David is let's show your T-shirt.
Let's see here.
A kid from Flint. He's a kid from Flint, but he's not a kid anymore.
I feel like a kid.
I know. But David, you're doing something that's very important. And is this your third one?
This third year, yes.
Okay. Tell the audience what it is.
So we are doing the Urban Entrepreneurship Symposium for the third year this year. The first year it was in Ann Arbor. Last year we did it in Detroit at the Center for Creative Studies.
Such a big turnout, too.
Oh, it was great. And you were a big contributor there.
Thank
you. Hope to get you involved again this year. And we're doing it in Flint this year, my hometown.
Right.
And basically what we do with this symposium, the organization is the Urban Entrepreneurship Initiative, and we try to encourage and facilitate business innovation, entrepreneurship, that solves problems for people who live in urban communities. And so the symposium is our way of highlighting the issue, connecting people who are involved in this pursuit, entrepreneurs and aspiring entrepreneurs and their allies.
And people, what I noticed last year from some of the people I talked about, people who were changing careers.
Definitely, yeah,
right.
A lot of people. And in Flint, you know, you have a lot of people who have already taken a step out of General Motors, you know, by necessity, either retirement or you know, change in their job circumstances, and they've moved into their own businesses and doing things in, to help the community as well.
Well, Flint has taken a big hit.
Definitely.
And yet it's on the national and international scope of things too.
Right.
And so it gets a lot of attention. So is that why you decided to have it in Flint, or tell us why?
Well, you know, again, Flint is my hometown, and I've been involved there for a number of years since moving back here.
Yes, you have.
And, you know, looking at the situation there, even before the water crisis, things were tough in Flint. And, and that's one of the reasons why the water crisis occurred, because there was this effort to save money. Because Flint was in such dire financial straits. So I felt like with the attention being paid to Flint, the spotlight being on Flint, it was a good time to go there with this symposium and to try to support people there who are trying to transform and revitalize the community, but also for us to learn what are really the kinds of things that are going on. What are people thinking? What do people want to do in Flint to revitalize that community themselves?
Right. What are you feeling? What are you feeling from the people? Because you've been kind of in the public the last few days in Flint, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I really feel a few things. One of the things is that, you know, we were in the MTA terminal downtown in Flint.
Now, what is that?
The bus terminal.
Okay.
Downtown. And basically, it's people taking the bus to different parts of Flint and down to Great Lakes Crossing, and that terminal is kind of the hub of activity. So we have this activity we're doing this year for the first time in association with the symposium, which we call Give Us What You Got. And basically what we're doing is we're going out and collecting short videos from people, and we ask them to give us a business idea that they have, or a community improvement suggestion, or just to describe a problem. And I kind of expected going into this that we were gonna hear a lot of problems from people, gripes.
Yeah.
We didn't. We heard people saying, this is my idea. You know, one young man said, I just finished electrical education at Baker University, and I wanna start a center where I can help teach kids coding and electronics and so forth. I want to establish a center in the neighborhood where I can do this.
That's a great
idea. And
people
had all kinds of ideas and things that they wanted to do. So it wasn't a negative thing. It was, here's what I want to do. And I think that one of the things that community leaders have to do, we have to do as leaders, is to look to empower these people rather than to look at them as some sort of victims. They want to be empowered.
Right. And when you were talking about that, I started thinking necessity is the power of the
mother of invention.
And right now, a lot of the people in Flint have found themselves in situations that, God, I'm out here helpless. I got to wait for the government to do this for me and that, you know, fix my pipes and all of that. And then a lot of people have roots in the community and don't want to move.
Yeah. So that whole situation with the water is just tragic. And the situation with the pipes, you know, lead service lines, have almost none of them have been replaced, a very small number so far. And that's a tremendous opportunity on the flip side to involve people. Flint has a very high unemployment rate. Involve some of these people in town in the infrastructure change that needs to occur there. So there's another couple of things that we're doing in connection with Flint that we've never done before
with the
symposium. We have two business model challenges that we established this year. One we call the Urban Infrastructure Challenge.
What does that?
So we're challenging entrepreneurs out there to come up. Excuse me, I don't know what it is. I don't have an allergy or anything this morning.
All right.
So. But we have we challenge entrepreneurs to come up with a business model that addresses some aspect of the infrastructure in Flint or a town like Flint. Could be water, transportation, communications. And we closed that challenge last Tuesday. We got the submissions in, and we're having the finals of that at the symposium.
Really?
We have another challenge, which is we call the Urban Jobs Challenge, and that one challenges entrepreneurs to construct a business model that will lead to a significant number of jobs in a place like Flint. And I've never seen anybody put forth a challenge in either of these areas before, so we were really anxious to see what kind of participation and what kind of submissions we got from people. But the finals of both of those challenges are going to take place during the symposium this year.
Oh, that's amazing. Because a lot of times you have the man on the street who has a great idea.
Definitely, definitely.
So the fact that they could be heard, or at least the idea could be seen.
Yep.
Is very, very important. What other things are you doing during the initiative this year?
Well,
the topic is urban revival, which I thought was a great topic.
We were thinking title. That whole theme of revival, like a revival meeting, but around the issue of entrepreneurship.
Renaissance.
Definitely. But as you mentioned, there are people out there who have ideas. And as you saw when you came to the symposium last year, one thing that's different about this event from other kinds of entrepreneurship events is that you don't see the usual suspects in the room. You see the usual suspects, but you see a lot of other people
you
as well.
You see so many other people. And one thing about it, I noticed when you asked the question, what would you do to make a city like Detroit, like it was last year, better? What ideas do you have?
Definitely.
And you're using Flint this year, which is so great.
Yeah. Yes, Flint is a good case in point, but I think that we're not going to be successful in Detroit or Flint or any of these cities with economic revitalization unless it's inclusive. We want to practice inclusive entrepreneurship, and we want to get everybody's ideas on the table, and we want to empower people wherever they are in that process to move along and get their ideas on the table and get businesses started.
Some people with ideas may coincide with that other person who might have an idea that can make this idea whole.
Yeah, we like to say that to solve a lot of these problems requires awareness, and it requires capability, and it requires motivation. And those three things don't always exist in the same person or the same community, so you gotta make those connections in order to hit the sweet spot.
Absolutely. So now this is 19th through 21st. What's happening each day? It starts on Wednesday
night. Yep. So this is the first time we're doing this over more than one day. It's a 3-day event.
I know.
This year. So on Wednesday night, because we're trying to emphasize this issue of inclusive entrepreneurship, the first night we call our community program, and it's 6 to 9 p.m. We have everybody from the mayor on down in Flint coming to this event.
Really?
And we want to talk about the importance of entrepreneurship, the importance of taking ownership in the community, and how people can do that. So that's what we're going to do on Wednesday
night.
She's
a pretty good woman, isn't she?
Well, she's been tireless, and she really, when the chips were down and when something needed to be done, she called out this issue and said, this is an emergency, right? She didn't allow it to be swept under the rug. So I give her a lot of credit for that. So we have that Wednesday night issue. And then on Thursday, we have what we call the conference program, which is a lot like what we did last year.
Right. But what time is that for?
So that's going to be like 9 to 6.
Where?
At the the first night is at Mott Community College, the Event Center. Uh-huh. The second day, the conference is at the North Bank Center, University of Michigan Flint, downtown. And so that day, we're going to have a lot of really interesting things. We have a fellow who wrote a book called Demolition Means Progress. And I would love for you, we got to hook up you talking to this guy, interviewing this guy. But basically, it is a treatment of the issue of what happened in Flint and other cities, economic rise and fall, and then the urban renewal.
I heard of him because somebody either
he was on WDET a few months ago. Yeah, right. Andrew Highsmith is his name. So he's coming. He's at UC Irvine now in California, but he's coming. And he's going to speak the morning of the 20th, there, that Thursday morning. We also have a collection of people who are going to come who are experts in building an entrepreneurship ecosystem. So we have Ned Stabler from Tech Town. We've got Leslie Smith, who used to be at Tech Town. Now she's in Memphis at something called Epicenter. We've got Mike Finney from MEDC. Who is involved in this revitalization effort in Flint. We've got a fellow from one of the venture capital firms up in Flint. But basically, we're putting this group of people together to talk about how do you go about building an effective entrepreneurship ecosystem in a place like Flint. And, you know, before I forget, I got to mention that we have some great partners in all of these things because University of Michigan, again, Center for Entrepreneurship, they are managing this urban infrastructure challenge for us. And University of Michigan Flint School of Management is managing the urban jobs challenge for us. And Mott Community College is a really great sponsor.
Now, did you speak to the urban jobs challenge?
Yes, that's the one where we're looking for business models that will lead to a significant number of jobs. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And so that is that Thursday.
That's Thursday, yes. Now, on Friday, if you recall last year, we had a lot of conference stuff going on in the morning. In the afternoon, we had seminars.
Yes.
And we had concurrent seminars going in different subjects.
Yes.
And people complained about that. They're like, I wanted to go to both of these
things. Right, right.
So on Friday, we're going back to Mott over to the Regional Technology Center, which is a beautiful facility, beautiful lecture hall there, and a maker space that's called the Fab Lab right there in the building. But we're going to have all of the seminars there, and they're sequential, right?
Oh, that's great.
Just on Friday. So we're going to have a seminar on, I'm going to teach a seminar on how do you go about starting an urban-focused business. What does that mean?
And what how does do you that mean?
It means a business that's focused on resolving and solving urban needs. But how do you identify what you do in that area, right? What's needed? And then how do you go about building that?
Okay. You don't, Highland Park or Detroit, what would you, an idea that would meet that?
Well, it depends. You know, you have to go out and talk to people.
Yes.
You have to immerse yourself in the community to understand what's needed. And I think a lot of times as entrepreneurs, and I did this myself when I started out in entrepreneurship, you feel like you know what people need. You know what you're going to do, right? It might be something you like to do. And you go out and you fail because it's not something that it's not an important need that people have. So one of the biggest things that we try to teach people now in entrepreneurship education is how to go out and do what we call customer discovery, or in this case, community discovery, so that you know what the issues are and what is needed. And then once you determine some significant important problem that needs to be solved, then it becomes a design process. How do I formulate and design a solution to this problem that is in the form of a business model, right? And then how do I go out and test that business model with people in the community so that I can see, will this really work?
Right.
And you do all that stuff before you start spending a lot of
money. Yeah, you get that information from the community, and after you kind of develop something, it goes back to the community, right?
You prototype your idea,
Absolutely. Yeah. So the urban revival, I like that. I like that idea. I'm very excited about this. It's a registration, right?
Yes.
It's free, right?
Well, the first night is free. The community program is free, but it does require registration online, urbanei.org. The second day, the full day is $25. Now, let me tell you what that includes. That includes the conference program, but that night we have another reception at the Flint Farmers Market, beautiful new facility. We have music, We have food. We have other entertainment. It's really, it's called The Matrix. So you can imagine what the theme is going to be like that night.
I can imagine. I can imagine.
So that's $25 for that whole day. And then the seminars program is $25 for the whole day. So
that's not for what you get, everybody. This is just amazing for what you get. And, you know, just talking to people.
Yeah.
Just talking to people too.
Contacts, yeah.
Contacts,
yeah.
As far as maybe you want to up your level or maybe you're thinking about changing careers.
Yeah.
I met so many people who were older who were looking to change careers or had started being an entrepreneur and wanted to know more.
Yeah.
And that's part of the value of this.
Definitely. And it's unusual that you would have this collection of characters in one
place. Right,
so
right.
So it's great to take advantage of that. You know, the reason we're able to do one night free and the other day's $25, again, is because of our sponsors. If we didn't have those, you know, this thing could be, $1,000 per person.
God, I know.
So, you know, I want people to take advantage of this value.
Well, David, this is great. This is fabulous. So once again, urbanei.org.
Yeah, everything is right there. And in fact, you can see the video from last year and the year before at that website, as well as the interviews that you did of some of the luminaries who were there on the website.
I was just amazed. I was amazed at the guy who had the space, the guy from New York.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh,
and they're coming to Detroit now. They signed a deal with Gilbert. They'll be in Detroit next year. Yeah.
Really?
So that's one of the things that
I gotta have him back. I would love to interview him for my viewers.
Miguel McKelvey.
Oh, he was wonderful.
That business is valued more than $15 billion now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Damn.
An idea.
Talk about urban entrepreneurship. When you say urban entrepreneurship, sometimes people think small, poor.
Uh-uh.
No,
uh-uh.
There's a great opportunity.
Well, David, thank you so much. And I will continue to push this next week. Yeah, next, because it's 2 weeks from.
2 weeks from
less
yesterday.
Than two,
yeah.
Two weeks from now.
Yeah.
Really, it's 2 weeks from Wednesday.
From Wednesday night, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
right. So thank you so much
again.
Thanks for having me again. Oh, of course. I miss you on Table Talk.
I'll be back.
Yeah, I want you to. And he's also teaching in Michigan.
Yeah, not this semester. I'm totally focused
on
this.
I know. And I was so impressed. I got to say this real quick. I was so impressed when you came by. You did the video of the house where you grew up.
Oh, yeah,
I was so impressed. Brought a lump to my throat.
Well, and saw some of the folks from the neighborhood still living there. That was really nice.
I know. Yeah. You know, that gives you that feeling of home, doesn't
definitely,
it?
Definitely.
They watched you grow up and be a bad boy. No, you are a good boy. You got to read Proving Ground, Amazon.com. We'll be back in just a moment with Sean Whitehead.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
I am back. I'm back with a young person. Speaking of entrepreneurs, he's a, I'd say you're an entrepreneur. You're a lawyer. I'd like to reintroduce a friend of the show, Sean Whitehead. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you, Ms. Perryman.
Oh, and congratulations, because the last time you were here, you were in law school. Now you are a lawyer.
That's correct.
But you're still involved in film.
Correct. Still doing entertainment.
Oh, that's your love.
It is. It's my passion. It's why I wake up in the morning.
Right. Well, this is exciting. Let's tell the audience what we have here.
Okay, so it's the International North American Film Festival. It's going to be on October 16th, 2016 at the Automotive Hall of Fame, right outside of Greenfield Village. It's a Sunday, all-day event, 13 different films. Four or five of them are international, spanning from France to Netherlands, and some local Detroit films as well.
Oh, that's exciting. That is so exciting. So what made you decide that you all were going to do this?
Well, you know, last time I was on the show a couple of years ago, we did the 10th, and we produced that, Emerald Sky, our nonprofit, and AIP Talent, our company.
With Barica.
Barica. So the two of us had done that with our team, and we had a great showing as far as the masses being able to be reached. We toured the film all the way to the Bahamas, had some discussions with HBCU Network, and they actually broadcast the 10th. We kind of build up a good grassroots following. And, you know, this time we were sitting at the table and we said, instead of, you know, showing one film that's ours, how about we show a dozen or films are other people and try to expose them? So we just kind of wanted to rejigger what we had done in the past and kind of do it in a new way.
This is exciting. And celebrating diverse urban landscapes in film.
Correct.
That's excellent. So, What made you decide to, because this is a diverse film festival, right?
It is. It shows a plethora of the diaspora that's in the world in regards to as high level as international films to urban and suburban. And it tells everybody's story. I feel like if you come out, whether you're male, female, no matter what your race.
Ethnic group,
I think you will actually see something that relates, that's relatable to you. At this film festival.
Absolutely. What are you looking forward to?
I'm looking forward to basically hosting it. So I will be, you know, making sure everything's going smooth and, you know, introducing you to announce the 2016 International Film Fest Award of the Year.
Right.
So I appreciate you doing that for us.
So let's do a little history of this. When did you start publicizing for submissions?
We started publicizing for submissions at the beginning of the year. So it's kind of been a long road, and we were kind of surprised with the turnout in regards to, especially on the international level, of the people that submitted. So we were able to narrow down our judge committee. We were able to narrow down to 13 films from there based on our point system.
Well, that's excellent. That is, I know you were a little surprised that you got so many.
So it is something we want to do in the future here. It's kind of a mix between Sundance and the Southwest Film Festival. There'll be music in between.
Oh, really?
And if you get a ticket, then you also get a pass to the museum.
So how do we get tickets?
You can go to www.inaff.org. That's
INAFF.org.
Correct. Or you can call our phone number, which is 347-767-4AIP. That's our company number. And we also have a local landline at 248-885-4288.
Okay, I want to go over those again one more time, because this is a week from Sunday.
Correct.
A week from Sunday. The films start at 11:30.
11:30. If you want to come a little earlier, there'll be some giveaways. There'll be a photo shoot with some of the actors and the directors and producers.
Oh.
So you can also tour the museum all day long as well. So.
Yeah, that's a great museum.
It is. It's very nice.
And that was an interesting place to do this, too.
Yeah, you know, because it's Motown, and you think of cars and records, and I want people to think of Motown movies now, you know, and so I figured this was a good central location to kind of display the spirit of Detroit.
Yeah, I have... Well, next year is the 50th anniversary of the riot, and I have this idea for a short film, a very short film. But I haven't even told my team that I've worked with about it. It's all in my head because I'm trying to figure out when do I have the time to do this, but I have to do it because I was there when the riot started. I was right on 12th Street and all of that. But anyway, neither here nor there. I'm excited about this, and you can learn about it. Remember, it's the International North American Film Festival. The website is www.inaff.org, and the phone numbers?
It's 248 is our local line, 885-4288, or you can call our New York number, which is 347-767-4AIP.
And some of you who have been doing films on the side, you need to come and do some networking. You may meet some great actors that you could use in your films and so forth. I'm excited. I'm going to be there all day long. So, Sean, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure.
Oh, always. Sorry I had to just bunch you in.
That's
but,
okay.
Oh, no, I'm very excited about this, and I'll announce it next week, too.
Sounds good to me.
So we should be back in just a moment with Table Talk.